Well, friends, good evening. Good evening and welcome to our 6 p.m. family Christmas service. It is wonderful having you all here today, seeing many familiar and a few new faces. For those of you who have not heard, our 6 p.m. service is our family Christmas Eve service. We've had a number of our children and our youth working on a program tonight. They'll lead us through to remind us of the meaning and the importance of Christmas, which means that our service will have very little of me talking and a whole lot of them leading us through worship. There'll be ample opportunities for us to sing together as well, and toward the end of service, we will break bread with one another as we celebrate communion on this Christmas Eve. I will do announcements now to kind of get them out of the way. Next Sunday, if you don't get enough hymn sing tonight, if you don't get enough Christmas carols tonight, next Sunday we have our annual hymn sing. And so we will have an MC up here who is going to lead everybody through their favorite Christmas carols. You can turn through your hymnal, call out your favorite numbers. We have a musician who's going to play and lead us through and have just a morning of singing and fun. And then in January, we're starting a sermon series entitled Big Questions. Those are questions that we hear often of people asking outside of the church to those inside the church. So we hope that you'll come back next Sunday. We hope that you'll come back the following Sunday as we begin to tackle some big questions together. With that, let me open with a word of prayer, and then we will get the show on the road. Let's pray. God of everlasting grace and mercy, on this wonderful Christmas Eve, as we are gathered together with friends and family from near and far away, we praise your holy name. Give thanks for the wonderful blessings that you have given to us through your Holy Spirit. We praise you and thank you especially for the gift of your Son, our Savior, whose birth we celebrate tonight, and whose return we look for with hope and with anticipation. Lead us through this time of worship. May the joy and excitement of the children and youth of this congregation be contagious. May their joy rub off onto us, that as we enter into this Christmas season, we do so with the joy and wonder of a child. We praise you. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
People longing for hope and yearning for deliverance, the prophet Isaiah declared, "The people who walk in darkness have seen a great light. Those who have lived in the land of darkness, on them light has shined. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and his name, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Isaiah 9, verse 2 through 6. These candles as signs of our shocking hope, our just peace, our fierce joy, the love that transforms us in Jesus Christ, our wondrous light. May the light burning in our heart guide us, comfort us, protect us, and tend us in all seasons and circumstances, reminding us that day and night, the light in the night and in the darkness, God is with us. Our salvation has come.
Before we let the children take over completely, we're going to start by singing together Angels from the Realms of Glory. We'll invite you to stand in body or in spirit as we do that. Can you hold on? I'm sorry, y'all. We sometimes have some technical difficulties. Yes. Martin, your mic needs to be turned on first. And I think I might have mislabeled that song. Because that was Angels We Have Heard on High. We need Angels from the Realms of Glory. The other one. So, yes, it would be very difficult to sing one song with the other one. I like to keep you on your toes. So we'll try that again. And I may have misnumbered them, which would have been my fault in the back. So we're looking from Angels from the Realms of Glory.
Thank you. Together this season. All you need is flour, eggs, butter, baking soda, baking powder, vanilla extract, and of course sugar to make a sweet treat. The recipe for a sweet Christmas is simple too. In fact, you could find all the ingredients in Luke chapter 2. There's Mary and Joseph, who are called to be the earthly parents of God's son, to God's son. There are shepherds with their sheep, and the angels who announce the birth to some shepherds. Most important of all, there's a baby lying in a manger who come to make life sweeter for all of us. Of all those sweet things we enjoy at Christmas, nothing is sweeter than knowing Jesus came to save us from sin. As we enjoy our sweet treats this season, may each one remind us of the sweet baby in the manger.
Hi everyone, and welcome back to the Sweetest Things Christmas Edition.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone, and welcome back to the Sweetest Things Christmas Edition. I'm your host, Becky, and with me once again, for no good reason, is Mr. Ebenezer Scrooge.
I beg to differ with you, young lady. There's an excellent reason I am here.
Really? You hate Christmas? You hate everything about the holiday. You humbug everything. Give me one good reason we have you here and not Buddy the Elf.
Because unlike Buddy the Elf, I'm in the public domain.
Bah, humbug.
See, you can say that all you want and the copyright attorneys won't get upset.
Let's just keep making the cookies, okay, pal?
That's Mr. Pal to you, Becky.
I'll stick to Mr. Scrooge, if that's okay.
Whatever you like, let's just make the cookies.
Mr. Scrooge, we have a batch of cookie dough ready to form. Would you mind rolling it out for me?
Roll it down the hole? That's not sanitary.
No, I mean roll it flat with a rolling pin.
Sounds like work for a commoner.
Remember, your agent said it would be good for your image.
Bah, humbug.
Scrooge is actually making the cookies.
He does it for me. He's still a Christmas hater. He is nothing but a big old meanie, and he will never change.
I don't know, Rose. I mean, Jesus didn't come to save everyone from sin.
Scrooge, right?
I don't know. Jesus didn't say anybody about Scrooge.
But do you really think anything can change Ebenezer Scrooge?
Thank you. As soon as you get it nice and flat, we'll start forming cookies with these cookie cutters.
What sort of cookie cutters?
Holiday cookie cutters, of course. I have a bell, a snowman, and a Christmas tree.
Are you really going to make cookies shaped like those horny things?
Of course we will.
You don't think round is good enough?
Round is perfectly fine, Mr. Scrooge. But these cookie cutters will bring out holiday into focus. Kind of like the wise men did when they visited the baby Jesus.
The wise guys?
The wise men? They were scholars who saw a bright star in the sky and followed it to visit the baby Jesus.
They couldn't be that wise. If they were, they wouldn't want to visit a baby. All they do is scream, cry, and mess their diapers.
I already told you, Jesus was no ordinary baby. He was God's son. That's why they bought him gifts.
What sort of gifts? Passies? Baby clothes? A bumbo seat?
No, no, no. Gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
They took those gifts to a baby?
Yes.
Those gifts aren't for a baby. Those are gifts for a king.
Now you see the story's taking shape.
I see some so-called wise men. I see them giving gifts to a baby. A baby who has already been visited by shepherds because an angel told them to. Say, this baby must have been someone pretty special.
That's what I keep trying to tell you.
But I hope they gave the gifts to his parents, not directly to him. Good coins could choke a kid.
I'm really starting to see why three ghosts came to visit you.
Ghosts? Don't believe in them.
I have a feeling you will. And I have a feeling you'll figure out why Jesus makes Christmas so sweet soon enough.
I gotta admit, I'm curious to know more.
Well, folks, our Christmas cookies are taking shape, and so is our Christmas story. Join us next time when we really turn up the heat.
Do we need cookie cutters to make our Christmas cookies? Do they make the cookies taste any better?
No, not at all.
Once they hit our tongues, they all taste the same. But let's be honest, cookies that look like snowmen, snowflakes, Christmas trees, and gingerbread men make the holiday sweeter. It's not just the taste, it's the symbols that remind us of the sweet, sweet time of the year we're enjoying. Jesus is just the baby when we met him in the Gospel of Matthew, but his true identity starts to take shape when wise men arrive. They bring gifts fit for a king, gold and precious spices that make that a mere carpenter and his wife could never afford. These gifts teach us that Jesus is the king. He is king of kings, and we should put our trust into him. He will be our king forever.
Hi, everyone, and welcome back to the Sweetest Things Christmas Edition. I'm your host, Becky, and with me once again is everybody's favorite Scrooge. I guess that's because he's the real Scrooge, Mr. Ebenezer Scrooge.
Hello, Becky.
Hello, Becky? Wow, that's the first time you've actually been cordial to me.
Is it? How rude of me.
Mr. Scrooge. Mr. Scrooge, are you okay?
Huh? Me? Yes, of course I'm okay.
You look like you've seen a ghost.
Really? Did you see it too?
See what?
Nothing, never mind.
Did you hear that, Chloe? Rainbow! I think Scrooge really saw a ghost. That's silly. There's no such thing as ghosts. There isn't a Christmas carol. But this isn't a Christmas carol. This is real life. A Christmas carol is just make-believe. Excuse me, kids. I'm looking for Ebenezer Scrooge. Who are you? I'm the ghost of Christmas past.
He's over there. I think he's live on TV right now.
He is? Okay, I can wait outside.
Did you hear that, Chloe? The ghost of Christmas past. Do you know what that means?
Yeah, as a ghost you're real, or you and me just make a belief.
Let's just get on with making some cookies.
Really? You want to bake the cookies?
That's what we're here for, right? We're baking cookies.
You are right. Although sometimes cookies don't make it to the oven.
They don't?
No! Cookie dough is sweet, and a lot of folks like to eat it raw.
That's crazy. You can't eat raw cookie dough. It has raw eggs in it.
Exactly. That's why we need to guard these cookies and protect them from...
ghosts?
I was going to say people want to eat them raw.
Oh. Well, they can have them. And not because I'm the stingiest man on Earth. I am the stingiest man. But this is an issue of public health.
You know, Mr. Scrooge, after Jesus was born, someone tried to put an end to Jesus' life before it had really begun.
Really?
King Herod was very jealous when he heard a newborn king was in his kingdom. He tried to find out where Jesus was through the wise men, but when they decided to take a different route, he tried to capture and kill the baby Jesus.
Ha! And they said, I need a visit from three spirits. Did you hear that? Marley, why don't we pay this Herod a visit?
You know, Herod is long dead, right?
That's what I thought about Marley till about an hour ago.
And Herod wasn't able to stop God's plans. God protected Jesus like a wise baker protecting his raw cookies.
So no one would get sick from eating raw cookie dough?
No, so that one day, Jesus could save the world from sin, from every bad, selfish, evil thing we've ever done.
Is this true? Jesus can really save us from our past sins?
Pretty sweet news, huh, Mr. Scrooge?
The sweetest thing I have ever heard, dear Becky.
Here's a hard, hard truth. Cookie dough is not a finished good. I know it tastes just as sweet as baked cookies, but raw cookie dough could actually make you sick. A dedicated cookie baker knows that they have to protect raw cookies so they can get them into the oven. Give them a little heat and finish preparing these sweet treats. Jesus and his family faced some heat when he was still a child. Harold turned up the heat when he tried to hunt baby down. Jealous there was another king in his kingdom. But like a good cookie baker, God protected Jesus. He got his son out of harm's way so that one day he could finish the sweet mission God gave him and save us from our sins.
Hi, everyone, and welcome back to the Sweetest Things Christmas Edition. I'm your host, Becky, and as you can see, I'm alone. I'm not exactly sure what happened to Mr. Scrooge, but based on what I saw during our last episode, I think he might have.
Merry Christmas, Becky! Merry Christmas, studio audience! Merry Christmas, children's choir.
Merry Christmas.
Mr. Scrooge.
Merry Christmas, you wonderful savings and loan.
Chicot Rose, Scrooge actually looked like the changed man. Do you think the ghost changed him? I don't know. He looks like a man who was changed by something bigger than a couple of ghosts.
Mr. Scrooge, are you okay?
I've never been better, Becky. It's Christmas time, don't you know? It's the sweetest time of the year.
I do, but...
Oh, look! The cookies are finally done. And it looks like you're about to ice them.
I was thinking about it.
You know, Becky, some people don't think cookies need icing. Some people think they're incomplete without them. But you know what I say?
The humbug?
No! I say it doesn't matter how you eat your cookies. The sweetest part of the Christmas season is knowing that Jesus is all we need.
It is?
Oh, come on, Becky. You're the one who's been teaching me about all these great things Jesus has done the last 4 episodes. You told me how sweet it was he came from heaven. You told me how sweet it was that he is God's son. You told me how sweet it is that nothing, not even King Harold, could stop God's plans.
I did say those things.
But one thing you didn't tell me, probably because you haven't gotten around to it, is that Jesus is all we need. Jesus can forgive our sins. He can give us new life. Jesus can give us eternal life. He can give all this and more because he is God's son. And he wants to do it all because he loves us.
You see, Rose, he was changed by something bigger than a ghost.
Something not at all make-believe.
Oh, Mr. Scrooge, you really have learned the true, true meaning of Christmas.
I have, Becky, and I want everyone to know about it.
Did you really get all that from three spirits who visited you?
No, not a bit of it. After they left. And after I sent some boy to buy a goose at Fort Bob's Carrots family, I sat down and read the Gospel of John. In the beginning, there was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus is that Word, Becky. He's the final Word. He doesn't need any icing. He's all we need.
So you don't want to ice those cookies?
I never said that, Becky. Let's ice those boughs and trees and snowmen. Let's deck them halls and put a sweet olive of icing on this holiday. But let's do so knowing that this, oh, this sweetness is nothing compared to the goodness of God who sent Jesus to be our Savior. Merry Christmas, Becky.
And God bless.
That's not your line. That's Tiny Tim's line. And yes, he does own the copyright.
Oh, good grief.
Icing is often the crowning touch for a cookie. Is it necessary? No. Does it make the cookie sweeter? It could. It certainly adds more color and pizzazz. Some cookies don't need the icing, but for others, it's the crowning touch on a sweet treat. If we believe in Jesus, we have all we need to ensure we will live forever. We don't need Jesus and anything else. We just need Jesus. Jesus fulfilled every prophecy of the Old Testament about Messiah. Jesus was the perfect man who made the perfect sacrifice to save us from imperfect sinners. He did it all for us, and there's nothing we could do to earn the sweet gift he offers us. The only thing for us to do is accept the gift he's given. Would you turn down a sweet treat like a lovely ice cookie? Not likely, right? Will you accept the sweet gift of eternal life Jesus offers you? It's our prayer you will. will so you could live life in all its sweetness.
This has been a lot of fun. We had good times, we ate some cookies, and we did some bubble things.
You mean like the fact that we're just make-believe?
No, well yes. But that's exciting, that's not exciting stuff. We learn about Jesus, his perfect plan for our salvation.
Yes, he is. He's a perfectly made cookie with icing on top.
He's the one who can save us from sin.
He's sweeter than any cookie we'll ever eat.
And Ebenezer Scrooge is one great artist with a tube of icing.
Yeah, that one really surprised me.
But even that is amazing, as we knowing that Jesus came to save the world from sin.
Merry Christmas, Chloe.
Go ahead and say it.
And God bless us every...
Thank you so much, you guys. We've had a lot of fun doing this.
I don't know about y'all, but I want to get into the Christmas cookies already. Once again, thank you to the children, to the youth, who have worked hard on this. And I think with that boot on, Ebenezer could have also played Tiny Tim. And also a huge thank you to Jody and to Dawn, it's all a sweet and wonderful reminder of the gift of Christ. And in this season of Christmas, we remember not only the birth of Jesus, but his life, his death, and his resurrection that brings us the hope, the new life, and the salvation that Scrooge eventually learned about by the end of the show. It's something that brings us great joy in this season. It's something that we celebrate, and it's something that we can take time to give back for. And for that, I'm going to invite the ushers forward that we might take time to give thanks to God by giving of our tithe and our offering. And as we do, we will take time to sing together, O Come, All Ye Faithful. You may remain seated as we sing together. I'm going to have Marjorie come up and help lead us through. Hopefully I gave him the right track this time, because you never know.
Adore him. Oh, come, let us adore.
God of grace, of mercy, and of light. On this evening, we give thanks for your gift, for your life, for the light and hope that was born into this world. May that light shine within each and every one of us, that we may shine unto the world, showing your love in everything we do. We praise you. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. So, in just a moment, we're going to gather around the communion table to break bread with one another. It's a tradition that I have loved to celebrate every Christmas Eve, is to break bread and to share in communion. I know we're celebrating the birth of Christ tonight. But as Christians, as we remember the birth, we must also look forward to his life, his death, and his resurrection. And so we cannot have the birth as Christians without keeping our eye toward Easter. I wanted to read a passage from the Old Testament prophet Isaiah, the 9th chapter, verses 2 through 7. And this is one of my favorite Christmas passages. There the prophet says, "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. Thou hast multiplied the nation, thou hast increased its joy. They rejoiced before you as with joy at the harvest, as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For every boot of the tramping warrior in battle tumults, and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. Upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So, a few brief words. Most church theologians, biblical scholars, will tell you that Jesus wasn't born in December. A census wouldn't have been taken at that time of year. Travel would have been unlikely. More likely, he was born in late spring, early summer. And at some point in time over the church's history, we have moved Christmas, the celebration of Jesus' birth, to December. Now, whether he was born in May, June, July, or actually in December, doesn't make too much difference. I think what is interesting, and something that we in the Northern Hemisphere can note, is that in the month of December, the days grow shorter and shorter. The light, the nights grow longer and longer. Darkness lasts longer in this time of year than at any other point. In the same way, in the month of December, many of us go through both amazing highs and difficult lows. The darkness of our own soul can be challenging. It can be difficult to piece through the month. It's important to remember then the words of Isaiah, that in the midst of the darkness, a great light has shone. Moving Christmas to December is a reminder that even in the longest nights, even in the darkest times of our lives, the light still shines. And we can have hope and faith, peace and joy, if we hold on to the fact that even in the midst of the darkness, God's light still shines in our midst. One of my favorite sermons from when I was in seminary lifted up Psalm 23. And he talked about the value of the valley. Yea, though I walk through the darkest valley, the valley of the shadow of death. And what he talked about there is that when there is a shadow, when there is darkness, it is a reminder that the light is coming. The shadow only exists for a time, and God's light will rise upon us. And on this Christmas, we celebrate that light, naming him Wonderful Counselor, Prince of Peace, Eternal Father. So on this Christmas Eve, as we celebrate the light, I say to you, Merry Christmas. And let us take time to join around this table, to break bread and to celebrate in communion with one another. In a short time, you'll be invited to come forward to take part in communion in at one of two stations. Be led by the ushers to come forward, be given a piece of bread, a small cup with juice in it. After you have received the bread and the juice, you may take as much time at the altar to pray as you'd like, to return to your seats and reflect. If you have need of gluten-free elements, we do have those available as well. And if you would like to receive communion but cannot make it forward, simply raise your hand. The ushers will make sure to see you and make sure the elements are brought to you. What's important as Christians is that we believe that this table is not St. John's table. It is not a United Methodist table. This is the Lord's table. And it is open to everyone. Don't need to be a member here or of the United Methodist Church. Simply one who is seeking the light in their own life. I'd invite you to grab your hymnals to turn to page 14 because you will see the calls and responses for the communion liturgy there. They may also be on the screen in front of you. Friends, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, creator of heaven and earth. You created light out of darkness and brought forth life on the earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. In the fullness of time, you gave your only Son, Christ Jesus, to be our Savior. And at his birth, the angels sang, "Glory to you in the highest, and peace to your people on earth." And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you. And blesses your Son, Jesus Christ. As Mary and Joseph went from Galilee to Bethlehem and there found no room, so Jesus went from Galilee to Jerusalem and was despised and rejected. As in the poverty of a stable, Jesus was born. So by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. As your word became flesh, born of a woman on that night long ago, so on the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When that supper was over, he took the cup, again gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. I'd invite those who are serving communion to begin making their way forward. As they do so, a reminder that the ushers will begin guiding you to come up the center aisle where you will be given a piece of bread. Go get the hand sanitizer. piece of bread and given a small cup with juice in it. After which, spend as much time in prayer at the altar rail as you would like. Set. The meal is prepared. Come, taste and see that the Lord is good. as we begin to draw the service to a close, we want to take time now to sing together two final songs. We will sing Silent Night, and then Angels We Have Heard on High. We're going to sing these a cappella, and I'm going to ask Marjorie to come up and lead us as we do. As she leads us in singing, we will begin sharing the light of Christ with one another. What I will do is I will take my candle, light it from the Christ candle here. The ushers will be coming forward and will light their candles off of mine and begin coming down the aisles to share the light of Christ with you. A few words about sharing these candles. For the children, if you have an electric candle, you may turn yours on at any time. For the adults, or for anybody with a wax candle, when the light is passed to you, please take the unlit candle and tip it into the lit candle. If you do it the other way around, you will spill hot wax down your hand, and it really does not feel good. So we will do this, and as the light is shared amongst us, we will begin, we will turn the chandeliers down in here so that we can enjoy the light of Christ coming from the candles. We'll wait until most of us have the light shared in our midst. And you are invited as we sing together to stand in body or in spirit as we sing together first Silent Night and then Angels We Have Heard on High. The words are printed in your bulletins as well as should be on the screens. But I'll invite the ushers forward that we might begin to pass the light amongst us.
So tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace. Thank you.
Jesus, Lord, thy silent night. Let us continue with our next song.
Okay, right. What's next song? Okay, good. This is not rehearsed, as you can tell.
Angels, we have heard on high, bid thee sing o'er the plains and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strains. Be which inspire your heavenly song. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Extinguish this candle on our way out, these candles on our way out. Remember that each of you carry within you the light of Christ. May that light shine out in everything that you do, so that when friends and family meet you, they would see God's love and realize that you possess within you the sweetest gift ever given. May they seek that gift forever.